All set? Okay, I'm on. Well, good morning, everybody. The last time when we were together, I said that we were going to get started on, we're really getting into the last phase of intellectual property, on understanding what intellectual property is, and getting into the area of infringement, which is obviously something that you need to know when it comes to intellectual property rights. But by way of introduction to that subject, I know that we haven't talked an awful lot about trademarks at this point, although we've touched on it. So by way of introduction of the subject of infringement, I want to talk today a little bit about trademark and sort of ease into infringement. I think that it'll bring everything that we've been talking together, and to that end, today we shall together endeavor to answer the immortal question, does Krusty Krab deserve trademark protection? Hopefully by the end of this class, you'll know the answer to that. But the answer to that, obviously, as I mentioned, has to do with an understanding of trademark. So trademark, what is it? Can anybody give me an example of a trademark, or what you think a trademark is? Is anybody wearing a T-shirt, for instance, from a famous school that might qualify? Yes, that's a. What did you have in mind?
Yeah, because it's MIT athletic shirt. I also had a hat with Kemp Kesson, which I know is Kemp, because we can't even put things on T-shirts unless it says Kemp Kesson under it for using the logo. So the whole thing together is TM, and you have to use it that way, which is interesting.
Two excellent examples of trademark. A trademark is any recognizable name, word, logo, phrase, sign, design, expression, or combination of those things, which identifies a particular product or service in the minds of consumers, essentially. And a trademark owner can be an individual, a business, a corporation, an association. It can be a famous university or a not so famous university. It can be owned by a lecturer that comes in every Tuesdays and Fridays to lecture at MIT, or it can be owned by a university. So a trademark is some sort of symbol or phrase or word that associates a particular product or service in the minds of consumers. And you mentioned that everything have to be TM'd. Do you know what the symbol TM means? Well, that's a pretty good guess. The symbol TM is used to provide notice to the public that a particular mark is considered by the user as a trademark. Now, have you also seen the little R that goes next to things? Well, the R is also a symbol for trademark, but it indicates that it's not only a trademark that the owner claims legal rights to, but it also indicates that it's been registered with the United States Patent and Trademark Office. So TM stands for trademark, or a trademark which is unregistered, and the little R with the circle around it is a trademark that has been registered. And there's an important difference between the two when it comes to the enforcement of trademark rights. But those two little symbols, in many ways, summarize the entire history of trademarks, and we'll go through it. But here's some examples that I could come up with of trademarks that some of you may be familiar with: Coca-Cola, Mickey Mouse, Batman, McDonald's, and the NBC Peacock. All examples of trademarks, all of them, by the way, registered. But these are examples of things which, you know, associate a particular product or service in the minds of consumers. And you can see, you know, when you look at the peacock, what do you think of? When you look at Mickey Mouse, what do you think of? Or Batman or Coca-Cola or McDonald's? There's a particular product or service that has become synonymous with those marks. Now, in the United States, trademark law has been protected since colonial times. But it wasn't until 1870 that Congress first attempted to establish a federal trademark regime. I need to talk to you a little bit about the two kinds of law that are out there. Can anybody tell me the difference between common law and statutory law? What do you think statutory law is based on? Check out the giant brain. Exactly. Statutes. Exactly. Statutory law is, let me tell you, you don't have to be that smart to go to law school. Trust me. The answers are really not that hard. Statutory law is any law that is derivative of statutes or conferred by statutes. And what is common law? Everything else, really. We basically inherited, some will say stole, all of the laws that we developed as a nation from our ancestors in Europe. Common law is law that is decided by judges. There's really no overarching framework. It's law that simply has developed over time based upon stare decisis, or the decisions of judges. Statutory law is a separate framework. It's when our legislators sit down together and codify certain rights that we have or obligations, such as trademark or copyright or patent statutes. But before the statutory law framework came into existence, we had common law rights that dealt with intellectual property. We talked about the history of patent law. We talked about the history of copyright law. Well, the same goes for trademark. Before there was a statutory framework that conferred benefits and responsibilities and rights regarding trademark, there was a framework of judicial decisions, otherwise known as common law, which defined people's rights to trademark, as well as copyright and patents. And these are basically laws that have been decided by judges based upon prior decisions that have developed over hundreds of years. And the two systems of law exist together where they don't contradict one another. The two systems of law are equal and you can enforce rights in both. So let me give you an example. If somebody violates a trademark or a copyright or a patent that you happen to own, you have rights against the infringer based upon not only the statutes which define what infringement is, but you also have rights that have developed as a matter of common law. And you can, for instance, sue in state court. If somebody violates, say, a trademark of yours, you can sue them in state court for damages based upon the common law rights that have developed. You can also choose to sue them in federal court based upon the federal statutory scheme that governs trademark, copyright, or a patent law. So there are these two sort of parallel universes of law out there that you need to be concerned with, especially when it comes to infringement, that define rights and remedies that you have as an owner of intellectual property. And you tend to go with whichever advantages you the most. There are certain strategic considerations that you have to take into account when deciding which universe of law to rely on. Oftentimes, what you'll do is sue for alternatively under both legal schemes. So, in any case, Here in Massachusetts, we recognize trademarks going back to the early 1600s. But finally, in 1870, Congress got into the act and they passed a law that purported to at least begin to develop a body of rights and remedies and requirements for a trademark. And of course, Congress can't do anything unless it has the power granted to it under the Constitution. And what Congress used to create this 1870 statutory scheme was the Copyright Clause. Now, we've dealt with the Copyright Clause before. We've looked at that part of the Constitution because we needed to look at that when it came to when it came to patents and it came to copyrights. The Copyright Clause is that part of the Constitution that gives Congress the power to regulate copyright and patents. And we've talked about that. We've talked about the useful arts and promoting the spread of knowledge. And so Congress in 1870 says, gee, well, you know what? We're going to develop a scheme of laws for trademarks, and we're going to use the Copyright Clause as authority for granting the statutory scheme. And here it is again. This is just a repeat of a slide that we've seen before in trademark and copyright. By way of review, Article 1, Section 8, Clause 8 of the United States Constitution, which is the Copyright Clause, states that Congress has the right to promote the progress of science and the useful arts for securing for limited times to authors and inventors the exclusive right to their respective writings and discoveries. Does trademark fall within that, do you think? Clearly, copyrights do if you write a book, and patents, certainly, useful arts fall within that, but do trademarks fall within that? Does the McDonald's logo fall within that? Does Krusty Krab fall within that? Well, if you say no, then you're correct, because in 1870, a bunch of merchants from Massachusetts brought what was called a series of cases called the trademark cases. And they were cases involving basically what we were famous for here in Massachusetts back then, champagne and whiskey. And what they did is they brought these cases challenging Congress's authority to grant trademark rights based upon the Copyright Clause. They said there's no such grant of power in the Copyright Clause, and the Supreme Court agreed with them. So Congress went back to the drawing board and in 1881 passed a similar statute, but this time made sure that everyone knew that they were passing it based upon the Commerce Clause of the United States Constitution. Article 1, which enumerates the powers of Congress, Section 8, but instead of Clause 8, they relied on Clause 3, which is, as I said, the Commerce Clause, which states that Congress has the power to regulate commerce with foreign nations and among the several states with the Indian tribes. Now, this is probably the most expansive clause in the United States Constitution. Congress has used this clause to do any number of things. It gives Congress the power to regulate interstate commerce. And one of those ways of regulating interstate commerce is to develop a statutory scheme involving the granting of trademarks, because trademarks are uniquely associated with commerce. Copyright is not necessarily associated with commerce. When I put my pen to paper and I draft anything from a musical composition to a children's story or even just notes to myself, I own the rights to that as the author. Not necessarily commercially necessary, though. I mean, it's not something that can be commercially exploited. But trademarks are something that almost universally are something that is associated with some kind of activity in commerce. Patents aren't necessarily considered something that would be involved in commercial exploitation. Lots of patents are, you know, not commercially exploited at all, and are owned for other reasons. So unlike copyrights and unlike patents, trademarks are really associated almost exclusively with commercial endeavors, and that's why it makes sense to use the Commerce Clause to confer those kinds of rights. I thought you might like to see an example of one of the first trademarks ever granted. This one was granted in 1870 to the William Underwood Company. Is anyone here old enough to remember Underwood Devil's Ham? Oh God, I'm really so old. Well, it was old when I was young, but there used to be a product that you could find on the supermarket shelves that looked like it's like a little can of mystery meat, and it was called, it predates Spam. Obviously, this goes back to 1870, but it's kind of like a spammy mystery meat. Anyhow, my dad used to eat it on sandwiches all the time, and all of the children used to run from the room because the darn stuff just smelled so bad. But, you know, people of a certain generation swore by it. My dad doesn't go back to 1870, despite what you might be thinking, but it is something that is of a different generation. But this is an example of one of the first trademarks ever granted. I think this is, trademark number 82. I couldn't come up with anything older than this, but that's the little deviled ham guy that consumers associated in their mind with this nasty little mystery meat product that members of my family used to enjoy every Saturday. Yes?
Do trademarks extend to perpetuity, or is there
What a great question. And I'm coming to the answer. One of the most important differences between trademarks, copyrights, and patents is their term. And let's see if we can answer the question as we go along. So speaking of statutory law, again, getting back to that framework, in 1946, Congress passed the Lanham Act. Now, the Lanham Act is the modern statute that we deal with. It's, in other words, Title 15 of the United States Code. But that is the body of statutory law that defines codifies the rights of trademark owners. But that does not do away with that other universe of law that I talked about. You still, as an owner of a trademark, have rights under common law that in some cases are superior to the rights that you have under federal statutory law. So as the owner of a trademark, you have to be conscious of the fact that you have rights that are conferred under the Lanham Act and all of the amendments, and as well under common law. And when you seek to enforce your trademark rights, you have to be cognizant of the fact that you have rights under state law and you have rights under federal statutory law. So while Congress may grant exclusive rights for only a limited period of time, it may extend the terms of the expiration of a period originally specified, and in doing so, protect the rights of publishers. And that starts to get into the question of how long these rights last. But let me take you through very briefly, assuming you're a person applying for a trademark, the various steps that are involved in obtaining a trademark. Again, everything is done online these days, so you go to the USPTO website. One of the reasons I said you should go to the USPTO website is to familiarize yourself with it and sort of see what intellectual property right owners need to do in order to enforce their intellectual property rights, whether they be patent, copyright, or trademark. But you go online, there's an online registration form, you click on it on the USPTO website, and you fill out the application. Very simple thing to do, name, address, email, address, number, and then you attach to it or click and drag your icon or your trademark symbol onto the application, and you submit it along with your application fee. That's the first step. That gets the ball rolling. What happens is then you get back a notification from the trademark office giving you a serial number. And about 3 months later, after your application is filed, it's reviewed by an examining attorney at the U.S. PTO. You should get familiar with acronyms that everybody uses in this business. The United States Patent and Trademark Office, which basically handles all intellectual property rights, whether it's patent, copyright, or trademark, is the clearinghouse for all of these things. And in the business, it's referred to as the USPTO. And so after the examining attorney gets your file, they will look at it for compliance with the rules of the trademark manual for examination procedure. Again, you can look at it right online. You can see what the examination process entails. It's not real complicated stuff, but it involves reviews of procedural matters, making sure that you've essentially crossed the T's and dotted the I's when it comes to the application process. And it also involves a more substantive review to see whether or not, for instance, your particular trademark might infringe or cause confusion with another similar mark that is already registered or where an application for registration is pending. Obviously, if you were to send in an application wanting to trademark the name McDonald's, it might run into some resistance from the examining attorney because there already is an existing trademark by that name out there. But then again, it may not. McDonald's is sort of associated with a particular product or a particular stream of commerce, usually involving hamburgers, French fries, and stuff like that. Well, if you're talking about an aircraft manufacturing company, you may be able to get trademark protection for that because it's a different stream of commerce. So not only is the name important, but more important than the name is whether or not it's going to cause confusion in the minds of the public when it comes to associating a particular product with that name. Yes?
So what if I was also in the hamburger business and I wanted to be called McDonald's, but I had a different syllable? So I didn't have the gold notches. I had some other, just like burgers.
You know, you'd probably get a cease and desist letter from McDonald's attorneys. One of the reasons for that is that what is very important about trademark ownership is use in commerce. Okay, as we'll find out, if you don't use it in commerce, you don't own it, and you're not entitled to protection. And one of the things that must be that comes with use in commerce is protecting your trademark. If you don't protect it, if you don't go out there and say, hey, you're causing confusion in the minds of consumers with your similar mark, then you could be considered to have either acquiesced in the use of a mark that is confusingly similar or even abandoned your mark in favor of another mark. So in a case where the stream of commerce is essentially the same, I'm betting that you're going to get a cease and desist letter from McDonald's. Even if you're just like a little mom and pop shop in some obscure city, you know, a one-off, and your name happens to be McDonald, you know, you can call it McDonald's restaurant. You can call it something descriptive, but to call it McDonald's, I think, even if you're just some little mom and pop operation, I think that you're going to get a cease and desist, and I think you're probably going to lose be on the losing end. Yeah.
That's got to interject. You ever seen the movie Coming to America?
Sure.
Eddie Murphy many years ago.
Yeah.
You may recall there was a subplot going on that the restaurant owner called it MacDonald's, like
yes.
The Scottish.
Yeah.
And they all wore Scotch plaid, and the McDonald's attorneys were after them.
Yeah. Kind of an interesting case, but what I like about it is it really does illustrate some of the things that I'm going to try to, you know, explain here today about trademark law. You know, the most important part is confusion. So if your mark is likely to cause confusion in the minds of the public, see, what are we protecting? We're protecting essentially with a trademark that goodwill that you have developed commercially that is associated with a particular sign or symbol. You've worked very hard. And so under the trademark laws, both common law and statutory, you're considered to have certain protectable rights. To the extent that somebody comes along and dilutes the value of that property or causes harm to your goodwill by creating confusion, in that case, you're probably infringing on the mark. You're more likely to be found to be infringing on the mark, which is, you know, keep in mind Krusty Krab's restaurant under the sea in the world of SpongeBob SquarePants, because that really is what I'm sort of coming to. But you know, probably a better example than I came up with Krusty the Krab. But it's a very interesting example. And by the way, what's the answer to the question? Does it infringe?
It causes confusion, I suppose it does.
Yeah, it depends. But yeah, right.
Yeah,
it remember, don't trust anybody, and it depends. But it probably does. You can bet that McDonald's would vigorously assert their trademark rights. And you know, I don't know of any cases offhand. But the answer of whether or not it does infringe will depend upon whether it's actually causing confusion. And what you do to prove it, by the way, is you know, as an attorney, you'll submit surveys. You know, you go out and survey 10,000 people and say, you know, what do you associate McDonald's with, you know? And you literally will offer these surveys in court or in front of the Trademark Trial and Appeal Board in an attempt to show that there is no confusion. You know, and you'll show that, you know, it's about a Scottish name. And, you know, you'll go into the etymology of the word McDonald's as opposed to McDonald's, in an effort to show that there's space between you and that McDonald's is trying to essentially own more than they're entitled to. You know, there are a lot of words in the English language that begin with M-A-C. You know what I mean? And, you know, does McDonald's own them all? If you ask McDonald's, they do. But if you ask everybody else who, you know, whose last name happens to begin with M-A-C, they don't. Yeah.
Last week you talked about
Yeah.
So what was the end result of that?
Well, I don't know, because the case is still pending. We're going to talk about it a little bit more next time when it comes to infringement. But again, you know, you can start, you begin to see the problems with the case, you know, and how aggressively, you know, people oftentimes try to enforce their trademark rights. And by the way, you know, you're sort of, if you're McDonald's or if you're Adidas, you're in a tough spot. Somebody comes up with a four-stripe design, you know, what are you supposed to do? Well, if you don't enforce your rights, will you be deemed to have abandoned them? And are you leaving yourself wide open for more infringement or more confusion? If you value the goodwill that you've developed as a company with your three-stripe design, you're almost compelled to try to enforce it. All right, so if the application violates any of the requirements, the examining attorney will issue an office action requiring the applicant to address the deficiency. If the examiner approves the application, it'll be published for opposition. And during this 30-day period, third parties who might be affected by the registration of the trademark, Krusty Krab, Swim Fins, whatever it happens to be, may step forward to file an opposition proceeding. If an opposition proceeding is instituted, then it is litigated in front of the Trademark Trial and Appeal Board. Again, McDonald's, Swim Fins, Krusty Krab, it'll be litigated in front of the TTAB. The TTAB is the administrative court. It's the arm of the U.S. Patent and Trademark Office, which is charged with enforcing or deciding whether or not a particular violation of intellectual property has occurred. You can sue essentially or file an action with the TTAB, but you also can bring suit you can bypass the TTAB and bring suit in federal court. There are oftentimes advantages to doing that. For instance, if you want to enjoin someone from using a mark, the TTAB can't make that sort of decision. They don't have the jurisdiction or the power to do that. So you may go straight to the United States District Court to enforce your trademark rights if you need to get an injunction or certain other types of relief. If you want to obtain damages, you go to the United States District Court. If you've been harmed monetarily, you go to the United States District Court because the United States District Court has the power with their jurisdiction to award damages. The TTAB can't award damages. But if you just want to decide the discrete question of whether or not the trademark should be canceled or whether the opposition proceeding should prevent someone from using a mark, then the TTAB is the cost-effective sort of administrative middle step way to go. If there is no third-party opposition, or if the opposition is decided in favor of the applicant, then what the TTAB or what the USPTO does is they place the mark on one of two registries that they have. There are two registries. One is called the Supplemental Registry, and one is called the Principal Registry. So in terms of the universe of trademark law, there are two registries for trademarks. All trademarks go into one of these two registries. One, the principal registry, which is the preferred registry, is reserved for marks that have distinctiveness or have acquired secondary meaning. All right? Now, the reason why the principal registry is the preferred of the two, assuming your mark has distinctiveness or has acquired secondary meaning, is because registration on the principal registry comes with certain perks. And one of them is that, for instance, you have nationwide constructive use and constructive notice with respect to the mark. So in other words, it's almost like a prima facie assumption that your mark is protected. And that's because the Trademark Trial and Appeal Board, or the USPTO, has decided that it's distinctive. It has a certain meaning. Let me give you an example of what I'm talking about. McDonald's is a distinctive mark and has acquired secondary meaning because it's associated with a particular brand of restaurant food, right? Well, how about the trademark Steve's Material Science Class, SMSC? Trademarkable? Yeah, why not? Is it distinctive? Has it acquired secondary meaning? It's not distinctive, it's more descriptive. So you have two kinds of marks. You have marks that are distinctive, that have secondary meaning. Those go on the principal registry. Steve's Material Science Class, that's more descriptive. When you think of it, do you think of a particular product? Do you think of a particular form of commerce? No. In fact, to know what it is, you have to sort of read it. And when you read it, it tells you what it is. The American Academy of Pediatricians. Okay? That, I'm sure, is a mark that initially was placed on the supplemental register. Why? Because it is descriptive. So a mark that is descriptive goes on the supplemental register. A mark that has distinctiveness or has acquired secondary meaning because of its use in commerce goes on the principal registration. Marks that are on the supplemental registration, descriptive marks, Steve's Material Science Class, can over time acquire secondary meaning and sort of graduate onto the principal register. And one way you do that is continuous use in commerce for 5 years. So if I were to trademark Steve's Material Science Class, the SMSC, if I were to trademark that, I'm sure the examining attorney would put it on the supplemental register. But let's say I teach this class every year for 5 years. 5 years from now, I could then file an affidavit with the USPTO and say, hey, I've been using this continuously in commerce for 5 years. And under the Lanham Act, under the statutory scheme that I told you about, under the Lanham Act, if I've used something in commerce for 5 years continuously, and I can show that, then I have, according to the law, acquired secondary meaning for my mark. And it's now considered distinctive. So during that 5 years, Steve Material Science class doesn't have any special trademark protection. But after 5 years, my descriptive mark can become can be placed on the principal register as distinctive because it's acquired by just by definition under the statute. Continuous use for 5 years magically makes it having acquired secondary meaning. So to be on the principal register, it has to be either distinctive or have acquired secondary meaning. McDonald's mark is distinctive. Steve's material science class is not distinctive, it's descriptive. And in order for me to get from the supplemental register, where I have no protection, essentially, to graduate to the principal registration, where I have all kinds of perks, I have to use it in commerce for 5 years. Once I've done that, and I can show the USPTO that I've done it for 5 years continuously, magically it becomes distinctive in the minds of the USPTO. And then I can register it with the USPTO, place it on the principal register, and then no one, so long as I continue to use the mark, can ever use the term Steve's Material Science class without coming to me. Okay? So that's the differences between marks. There are all kinds of marks out there. Any word or phrase or sign or combination of words or letters qualifies for a trademark, but they fall into two different categories usually. Descriptive phrases or marks, or distinctive marks. Descriptive marks go on the supplemental register where you don't have a lot of rights. Distinctive marks go on the principal registry, which have lots of great rights, great perks. And in order for you to get from supplemental registration to principal registration, if you happen to have a descriptive mark, you have to use it in commerce for 5 years continuously. And then magically in the eyes of the USPTO, and I say that because really nothing changes from year one to year five except you're just using the thing for 5 years. I mean, there's really nothing, doesn't become more distinctive, I guess, except that you qualify for what the statute defines as distinctiveness. And that's, you know, could it have been 4 years? Could it have been 6 years? You know, I don't know why they chose 5 years, but they did. But you do it for 5 years, you've acquired secondary meaning, and you end up on the principal registry. Yes?
Graduating from supplemental principles, is that equal to graduating from TM to R with a circle around it?
No, two different things, although both represent graduations. TM means that you consider the mark a trademark. You have trademark rights, and you can enforce trademark rights, as I said, under common law. You don't have to adopt this federal system. You can, Joe's Hamburgers. You know that has certain rights under common law that have developed over hundreds of years. Now, if you decide to register that at some point, and you can at any point, you don't give up your common law rights, but you can add to them by registering the mark, then you go from TM to R. So TM to R is basically a graduation from a common law trademark to a registered trademark. Once you register it, the Lanham Act kicks in. The principal registry kicks in, the supplemental registry kicks in. Okay, that whole, all the framework involved in the statutory, the Lanham Act, becomes applicable. But you can stay outside that forever and a day if you want and just stay over here and have your little TM and still have the rights to that mark. Now, if somebody comes along and infringes and you want attorney's fees and if you want other damages that are available under the statutory framework that are not available under common law, then you got to register it. And it doesn't matter. You can register it the day you file a lawsuit. I've actually taken cases, trademark cases, where the guy has been using this trademark for, you know, 2 decades, and somebody comes along and infringes, and we decide to sue them. What I'll do is I'll have them register the mark the day before that we bring the lawsuit. And then when we bring the lawsuit, we not only seek to enforce our common law remedies, but we also bring claims under the federal statutory framework. And for reasons I'm about to get into, he's entitled to those rights because there's something unique about trademark that sets it apart from patents and copyrights. All right, so I think we've covered supplemental registration. The only thing I didn't mention about supplemental registration is the reason it exists at all. The reason it exists is because we needed some form of registration in order to provide trademark owners with the ability to enforce trademarks overseas. So if you want to enforce your mark overseas, there had to be some way for you to register. If you can't register a mark in the United States on the principal registry because it's not distinctive, because it's only descriptive, you can register it on the supplemental register, and then you can enforce those rights in other countries. Other countries don't necessarily make a distinction between supplemental and principal registration, between descriptive and distinctive marks. So the only other reason why the supplemental registry exists is for foreign registration. Now, maintaining trademark rights, and I'm getting to the answer to your question. The key to trademark registration and the and trademark ownership is use in commerce. You can't think something up, you can't design a logo and keep it to yourself. If you don't use it in commerce, you don't own anything. So, for instance, if I think up of a trademark and it's a brilliant trademark to describe a product or a or an invention I have, and that I'm planning to sell or market, and I don't plan and I don't sell or market it, if I don't raise any money, if I don't use it in commerce in some way, and somebody else comes along and thinks up the same mark and uses it in commerce, even though they think of it after me, they own it. Use in commerce. So it's not just the idea or thinking it up or anything like that that confers trademark ownership. And this is what makes it different from patents and copyrights. The key to trademark ownership is use in commerce. No use in commerce, no ownership. And that's the simple rule about trademarks. And generally speaking, if you don't use it in commerce continuously, you essentially abandon it. If you don't use it in commerce for 5 years, it is considered prima facie evidence of abandonment, and somebody else can come along and use it. If you happen to use it intermittently and somebody comes along and starts using your mark and they challenge your use of the mark, you're going to have to go before the Trademark Trial and Appeal Board or the district court and prove that you've used this thing in commerce. How would you prove that you've used a trademark in commerce? Can anybody wearing a hat or a t-shirt with a famous logo on it come up with an answer to that?
Show that you have a product that's been selling with it on it?
Sure. If you can show t-shirts, not only t-shirts, but t-shirt sales, right? What were you going to say?
Show an advertisement or something like that using a trademark?
Usually advertising is not enough. Okay. You have to have also, you have to also show some sales. But even one sale will usually be enough. So the use in commerce doesn't have to be large. It doesn't have to be, to coin a phrase, huge or the biggest or the best. Any sort of use in commerce will do. And, and that's because not all commercial uses of marks are large, like McDonald's. You know, the good thing about trademark law is that big is not better. Even a little guy who came up with the term McDonald's before the giant corporation came along and adopted the term. It's the little guy who used it in commerce first. Somebody that comes along, no matter how big they are, if they infringe on someone else's right, according in the words of the U.S. Court of Appeals for the Federal Circuit, does so at their peril. Because it's not the size of the user or the wealth of the user or how important the user is or how influential the user is. It's whether the user used it first in commerce. Remember the case with the was it WWF? World Wrestling Federation. There's a $1 billion corporation was using the term WWF. Except before the WWF, who was it? That's right. And who won that case? Why? Because they were first to use it in commerce. Exactly. So the $1 billion corporation lost to this little nonprofit. Why? Because the little nonprofit came along and used it first. Had they registered it? Nope. Were they on the supplemental or principal registry? Nope. They've just been using it. So it doesn't matter whether you're on the supplemental register, the principal register. It doesn't matter whether you've registered at all. As long as you've used it in commerce, under federal and state law, the first one to use it in commerce owns it, no matter how little you are. Yeah?
Getting to the last bullet there, it sounds like if the World Wrestling Federation had filed to an application to be removal because World Wildlife Foundation had not said, "Hey, you're infringing." They could apply and say, "Hey, they didn't come after us for infringing." It sounds like the burden
is right
on the people being infringed upon.
That's one of the problems. Remember what I said earlier. It's like Adidas is in a tough spot. Somebody comes along that, they don't want to necessarily do this, but they see somebody comes along with a design which they believe is confusingly similar or may impact their continuous use of the mark. They're almost forced. I send a lot of cease and desist letters out because my clients have got to do that to show that they are policing their mark. That's it's like putting a fence around your property. If you let people just walk over your property, in fact, in property law, that's actually a fact. In property law, if for any particular, depending upon what state you're in, but it's usually can be set between 7 and 21 years, but if you let people just cross your property for a particular period of time, there's a public easement. You can't put up a fence, even though you own the property. And it's the same way with trademark law. Trademark law says that without that, you're sunk. So ownership rights flow from prior use. That's the thing I really want to make a point of. So how long do trademark rights last? In answer to the question, unlike other forms of intellectual property, trademark rights can theoretically last forever. As long as the trademark's use is continuous in commerce, the trademark rights are in force and effect. So now there are certain, again, that's the case with common law, with state law. With respect to the federal statutory scheme, there are certain things that you have to do periodically. You have to file. Remember I told you about the supplemental registration converting to a principal registration? You file what's called a Section 8 certificate with the trademark trial, with the USPTO, and you say, I've been using this continuously for 5 years. And so that affidavit essentially renews your trademark. So continuous use is necessary, but also under the statutory framework, you have to file certain applications proving continuous use every 5 and every 10 years. All right, so I have a quick question for you. Who can solve the problem? In 2015, inventor A begins using the mark swim fins to describe a clever invention he's created and plans to market to swimmers. In 2016, inventor B comes along and begins using the mark swim fins to describe a clever invention he has created and plans to market to swimmers. unbeknownst to inventor A, inventor B immediately goes down because he has a good lawyer and registers the swim fins mark with the USPTO in 2016. But because he doesn't have any money, he can't really market the product yet. Meanwhile, inventor A sells $10,000 worth of swim fins between 2015 and 2017 to swimmers that he meets at swim meets. When inventor A tries to register the swim fins mark with the USPTO, he finds out that the mark has already been registered by inventor B. Who owns the mark?
Inventor A.
Why? Use and commerce, exactly. What inventor A is probably going to have to do, because the mark has been registered, is, depending upon whether it's on the supplemental register or on the principal registry, swim fins is probably distinctive, but it's also descriptive. So depending upon where the USPTO put his mark, put inventor B's mark, they'll probably have to file either an opposition procedure or proceeding or a cancellation proceeding. And they go in and they say, USPTO, you have to cancel this trademark because I've been using it in commerce prior to this person. And the universal principle that applies to trademark is first to use in commerce owns the mark. And inventor A probably will, even though inventor A was a little slower, will probably, I think, get ownership of the mark. So it's first use in commerce, not first to use, not first to think of, not who designed it, not who authored it. That's what makes it different from copyright. It's not first to file. That's why it's different from patents. It's first to use in commerce. That's the universal prevailing principle when it comes to trademark. All right, a couple of examples. Subway sent a cease and desist letter to vendors before it actually owned the rights to footlong. Subway actually applied for trademark protection for the term footlong. I believe they actually at some point got it. It may have been canceled since then. I don't know. Harley Davidson tried to trademark the sound of its engine. Was that successful? What do you think? Is that trademarkable, the sound of a Harley Davidson engine? That's the analysis you have to do. The Trademark Trial and Appeal Board said, nah.
How do they even do that? Do you just get the actual...
You bring in...
It is 10% different.
That's exactly what you do. You get acoustical engineers, you bring in recordings, you play it, and you say, this is why our mark is distinctive. Nobody else can make this noise with an internal combustion engine. The other side brings in their acoustical engineers and their mechanical engineers, and they say, watch, I can make this sound, you know, in two notes. And then the Trademark Trial and Appeal Board decides. Using the principles, you know, so I guess the point is that I have a couple of other examples. In addition to your pictures, guess who owns the word face? Yep, Mark Zuckerberg. But fortunately for everyone here, only in the context of commercial telecommunications business.
FaceTime. Like Apple's FaceTime?
Yeah.
Is that like
the
licensing on this?
Well, Apple would. Apple says no because it's FaceTime. Facebook says yes, we own it. It may come down to the particular use to which it's being put. Okay. Again, it's like claims in a patent. It really begin at some point to sort of slice the bologna kind of thin and find out exactly what the use is, identifying that stream of commerce. Yeah.
What if Facebook now does like virtual communication that is like FaceTime essentially, and they now encompass that?
I think well, who was first to use it in a commercial setting?
Facebook was first. So Facebook was first.
Application.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, the application. Facebook was first.
So I think in that particular case, not knowing much about it, but I think in that particular case, Apple may be okay for that particular stream of commerce. But again, it really has to do with how consumers identify a mark and what they associate it with.
So it's not like with the patents, how I can just add a claim to my patent or patent, and then it then encompasses everything in that other person.
No, you've got to prove a particular association. It's distinctive for a reason. What is it distinctive for? You know, McDonald's is famous for cheeseburgers, not for mufflers. Okay, and that's essentially, you know, again, sort of an easy example, but that's the essential of the analysis. But speaking of Apple, Apple owns the rights to app, believe it or not. Twitter, I thought this was kind of fun. Twitter lost the word tweet to a third-party developer because they made a mistake in their application. The USPTO rejected Twitter's application because of an earlier claim by a third-party developer, TwitAd. So Twitter, unfortunately, doesn't own Tweet. Yes.
But in that sense, like, I mean, does it matter? Like, in the public mind, I think people associate Tweet with
TwitAd. You're right. I don't think it matters to Twitter, but if you want official protection, you can have it. All right, I come back to my question. I'll give you the case. Somebody opened a restaurant in California called Krusty Krab, and Viacom brought suit against this little mom-and-pop restaurant shop saying, we own Krusty Krab, you can't use Krusty Krab. Krusty Krab is the name of the restaurant that Krusty Krab in SpongeBob SquarePants world. So you can't use it. What was the decision?
Spelled the same with the K.
Spelled exactly the same. You're asking all the right questions. The judge that wrote the decision holding that Krusty Krab was entitled to block the use of their Krusty Krab name from the use in a restaurant said that even though the uses are different, one is a cartoon and one is a restaurant, Viacom consumers may believe that restaurant is associated in some way with the Viacom brand, like Bubba Gum Shrimp, right? All right, well, Bubba Gum Shrimp is completely a creation of... So that's why, even though it's a different form of commerce, the judge focused on the confusion arising from thinking that it was licensed. So Krusty the Krab got protection, and the poor mom-and-pop crab shop in Long Beach couldn't use the name. They had to come up with something else. All right, so that's my way of introducing you to infringement. On Tuesday, I'm going to go through infringement. We'll talk more about the Adidas case. We'll talk about the CRISPR case. We'll talk about enforcing your intellectual property rights, what you have to watch out for. And I'm thinking, because I've had a lot of questions, of having one more expert come in and take you through from conception to non-provisional patent application grant an entire example of how to do a patent. We've got so many people here working on patents. There have been so many questions about, you know, the practical aspects of whether you should have filed for a patent and how. And I thought if you guys are interested in it, I'll have somebody come back one more time and talk to you about literally from concept to proof of concept and commercial application every step along the way. Does that sound like something you'd like to do? All right, so maybe next Friday we'll do that. And we're getting close to the end. Spring break is coming up. I've only got maybe 3 or 4 more lectures. We're really covered an awful lot of ground. We're getting close. You now know more than most law students do about intellectual property. So you can add that to your resumes. I hope some of this has been helpful. See you next Tuesday. And don't forget the gourmet scones. Okay?